Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 52, Caesar Augustus. Antony and Cleopatra were dead, though no one knew it at the time, when Octavian emerged victorious from the brief war with his old triumvir colleague in 30 BC. He was also ending nearly 20 years of continuous civil war. From the time Julius Caesar crossed the Rubicon in 49 BC, the empire had been subjected to almost two decades of constant civil strife. Had the sickly Octavian died young, no doubt the victory at Actium and the conquest of Alexandria would have been just two more milestones on the long road to stability. But much to everyone's surprise, not the least of which his own, Octavian wound up living well into his 70s. This meant that his victories were not just a few more markers along the way. They turned out to be the destination. So what was that destination? Was the Republic really dead? Would things ever go back to the way they had been before? Did anyone want things to go back to the way they had been before? Who was in control now? The Senate? Octavian? And what about the 60 legions still in arms? These were open questions with no obvious answers. We of course know now how things turned out, and know the ABCs of how Octavian solidified his personal rule, and what that meant for the long-term makeup and outlook of the Roman Empire. But as the victorious young Caesar sailed back to Rome in 30 BC, no one knew what was going to happen next. When Octavian arrived home in August of that year, though it was not called August yet, and we'll get to that, the great constitutional questions did not have to be addressed straight away. He was, after all, still consul, which gave him all the legitimate power he needed to rule the empire. Eventually, being elected consul year after year would no longer be a sustainable base upon which to rest his authority, but for now, it was enough. His first steps were to sort through all the friends and enemies he had made in the previous decade and decide what to do with them all. First up on the list of names, Mark Antony, of course. Now you may think, well, Mark Antony is dead, so isn't that enough? And the answer is that no, it wasn't enough. Octavian wanted his old rival erased from the collective consciousness, so he ordered that Antony's name be literally purged from the history books. The official annals that recorded the events of the year were opened and edited. Every mention of Marcus Antonius was erased. The same was done to various monuments and statues that had been erected in the last 30 years and still bore his name. Finally, it was decreed that no future son of the Antonius clan could be named Marcus. Octavian was making it clear that there is no Mark Antony, there never was a Mark Antony, and that we have always been at war with East Asia. As for the former allies of the now non-existent Mark Antony, Octavian decided their fates on a case-by-case basis. Unlike his uncle, Octavian was predisposed towards bloody vengeance, but with Maecenas acting as a moderating hand behind the scenes, Octavian actually ordered as many pardons as he did executions. The die-hard anti-Caesarians were killed or exiled, but the rest of his former enemies were folded into the new regime. The latter fact was highly publicized, the former not so much. In 29 BC, Octavian continued to serve as consul. Being an extremely deliberate and patient man, Octavian knew that the process of transforming himself into something bigger and greater than anything Rome had yet known would be a long process. For now, he would serve as the traditional executive, but he planned much greater heights for himself in the future. To prepare the population for his ascent to near godhood, Octavian had Maecenas set his army of poets to the task of glorifying their newly victorious patron. The culmination of the poetic propaganda campaign was, of course, the Aeneid, written by Virgil. Begun soon after Octavian's return to Rome, the epic poem would be published a decade later and eventually stand as one of the few great masterpieces of Latin verse. Though the quality of the work was no doubt a pleasant bonus, Octavian, by then Augustus, was most pleased to find Virgil taking pains to highlight the Julii clan's connection to Aeneas and the description of Augustus's ascent to power as a preordained inevitability. The myth of Augustus was beginning to take shape. The highlight of the year was the celebration of three triumphs in Octavian's honor, one each for his victories in Illyricum, Alexandria, and at Actium. Of course, with Antony now written out of the history books, the triumphs celebrating Actium and Alexandria were recast as victories over Cleopatra alone, the demonic Eastern Queen who had tried to conquer noble Rome. For these latter two events, Octavian forced Cleopatra's children to parade through the streets of Rome in chains. Conspicuously absent, though, was 15-year-old Caesarion. As the one real threat to Octavian's claim on the Caesar name, there was no way Octavian was going to let young Caesarion make it out of Alexandria alive. Famously remarking that two Caesars is one Caesar too many, Octavian had the boy executed. It may seem harsh, but in Roman society, when a boy reaches the age of 18 and passes through the rituals of manhood, he is a man, no less so because he is a young one. There is no hesitating over Caesarion's fate. Two Caesars is one Caesar too many. The rest of the children were handed over to Octavia to care for, and she attended to them lovingly until the eldest daughter was married to the king of Numidia. The new bride took her brothers and sisters with her to Africa, where they lived the rest of their lives in peaceful obscurity. But just as the triumphs marked the passing of Cleopatra's young children from the world stage, the celebrations also saw the introduction of two Roman teenagers onto the same stage. Joining Octavian in his triumphal chariot were 14-year-old Marcus Claudius Marcellus, the eldest son of Octavia, and 13-year-old Tiberius Claudius Nero, Octavian's stepson. There was no mistaking the dynastic implications of their prominent inclusion in the procession. Soon enough, it would become clear that Octavian was grooming his nephew Marcellus to succeed him, just as his uncle Julius Caesar had groomed him to rule the empire. Tiberius, despite heavy lobbying from his mother Livia, would remain a backup plan. In fact, he would remain the backup plan for most of his life, as Augustus cast about the family, trying to find someone, anyone who could replace him. In the end, he was able to find none, and Tiberius, who was never supposed to become emperor, became emperor. In 28 BC, Agrippa joined Octavian in the consulship, and the two worked together to shore up Octavian's power, while simultaneously restoring order to the empire. One of the first things they did was formally annul all the laws that had been enacted during the Second Triumvirate. As I mentioned at the end of last week, it was time for Octavian to leave his ruthlessly ambitious past behind him. So it may seem odd that he canceled laws and decrees he himself had enacted just a few years previously, but he wanted to send the message that he was not that man anymore, that the rule of law had returned to Rome for good. Canceling a few laws, though, was just a matter of bookkeeping. The real question facing Octavian and Agrippa was what to do with the 60 legions that remained mobilized. Obviously, there was no need to keep so many men under arms. Not only could the treasury not support them, but what were they all going to do? Knowing full well that a restless army is a dangerous army, Octavian and Agrippa worked through a plan to demobilize half the men and keep the rest posted on the frontiers where they would guard the empire from foreign invasion. Eventually, they settled at keeping on 28 legions, around 150,000 men, posted primarily in Gaul, Spain, and Syria. As I mentioned last week, one of Octavian's overriding goals after Actium was to capture Egypt and hold it as a personal territory. Having achieved this goal, he was now able to more or less tell 150,000 soldiers to go home without worrying about bonus riots. Here's your retirement check, paid for from the riches captured in Alexandria. Have a nice life. No IOUs this time around. He had money to pay them all. During this year, Octavian and Agrippa also appointed themselves to be censors, the powerful office that was in charge not only of the mundane task of determining the population, but also the much more controversial task of determining who was in and who was out of the Senate. Right away, they fiddled with the senatorial ranks, reducing the total number from 1,000 to 800, and subbing in prominent supporters from across the empire, rather than relying strictly on old Roman families to fill the ranks. The pushback from the existing Senate, though, was swift, and Octavian prudently backed off his plan, granting waivers to anyone who wanted to remain in the Senate to settle the matter. But like I say, Octavian was a patient man. By no means was he done trying to mold the Senate into something more to his liking. But there was no reason to risk it all in a showdown with the old guard right away. There were still appearances to keep up. Over the course of 28 BC, Octavian and Agrippa also added two great temples to the Roman skyline. beginning the process of turning the city of brick into a city of marble. First was the temple to Apollo that Octavian had vowed to build if he emerged victorious from the war with Sextus Pompey. Built on the Palatine Hill, adjacent to his slowly expanding residence, the temple would take on great public significance when Octavian ordered that the Sibylline books be moved there from the Temple of Jupiter, where they had been kept from the time of the kings. Ever so subtly, Octavian was consolidating all power, religious, political, and martial, under his own roof. Agrippa, meanwhile, took the lead on building a great temple to all the gods, to be called simply the Pantheon. Today, the Pantheon remains one of the great tourist destinations in Rome, and if you ever get a chance to see it, don't miss out. Keep in mind, though, that the Pantheon standing today is actually a rebuild commissioned by Trajan in 126 BC, the original construction having been destroyed by a devastating fire in 80 AD. But, cognizant of the historical significance of the temple, Trajan ordered his Pantheon built to the original blueprints, right down to the inscription on the cornerstone, which reads, "Marcus Agrippa, son of Lucius, consul for the third time, built this." It's pretty cool. As 27 BC arrived, Octavian felt secure enough in his position that he decided to work out the details of his new world order with the Senate. The trick, of course, was to maintain the pretense of republican governance while at the same time keeping power in his own hands. In performing this trick, he was actually aided by a willing Senate. You may think that the body who stood to lose the most by Octavian's power grab would also protest the most. But while some members disliked Octavian's rule, most of the hardcore Republicans had long since been purged and replaced by men handpicked by Octavian. Not surprisingly, when in January 27 BC, Octavian announced to the assembled body that he was stepping down from his position and wished no more to bear the burdens of government, the senators present tripped over themselves, begging Octavian to reconsider. Reluctantly, Octavian agreed that if the Senate, as the representatives of Republican authority, deemed him worthy of remaining Rome's leading man, how could he possibly say no? The deal worked out with the Senate, all arranged in advance, of course, granted Octavian 10 years proconsular authority over the provinces of Spain, Gaul, Cilicia, Syria, and Egypt. These particular provinces were important because they all stood on the borders of the empire. If a foreign threat, say from the Germans or the Parthians, was going to threaten Rome, it was essential that the strong and wise hand of Octavian was there to protect the empire. The brass tacks of the agreement, though, was that of the 28 standing legions, 20 of them were stationed in provinces ceded to Octavian. There had never been any confusion about where young Caesar's authority had always rested. With this grant of proconsular authority, Octavian guaranteed that three-quarters of Rome's military was under his personal command. The rest of the provinces were left to the Senate to administer. If you go to thehistoryofrome.typepad.com, you'll find a map breaking down the territorial divisions of the 27 BC settlement. As you may have noticed, these agreements showed that unlike Julius Caesar, who had pushed a radical new governmental structure, Octavian was seeking to work within existing precedent. He was not proclaiming himself dictator for life or a new king of Rome. He was simply a humble consul, duly elected by the people, who had been granted by the Senate's authority proconsular powers wherever they had seen fit for him to govern. Who was he to argue with the representatives of the people? The last little bit to come out of the constitutional settlement of 27 BC was the small matter of what to call Octavian in this new order. The Senate decided that he ought to at least be given a title of some distinction, something that acknowledged the indispensable nature of the man. The Senate finally settled on a new name, the name by which most people know Octavian today, and the name by which this podcast will henceforth refer to him, Augustus, or Revered One. If this were a History Channel documentary, this is the point where we would cue a new actor for the reenactment. Gone the fresh-faced young man, replaced by the serious-faced old man. I had toyed with the notion, and if I had more guts I might have done it, of eschewing the common practice of referring to him as Augustus from this point on. I think the name switch has the effect of subconsciously dividing up his career, making it seem as if it really was two different men doing all of these things. To call him Octavian through the last portion of his life would really bring home the idea that it is Octavian who's ruling the empire from here on, not some new guy named Augustus who was called in off the bench as a second-half replacement, the wise and all-knowing substitute for the young and ruthless starter. I'm not going to do it because sometimes fighting convention just isn't worth it. But please don't forget to keep the same face in your mind when you picture Octavian now as Caesar Augustus. Don't replace the actor in your head. He is still the same man. To complicate things even further, just as Octavian never really went by Octavian, he was always Gaius Julius Caesar to the Romans, he never really went by Augustus much either. When you're trying to maintain the facade of Republican virtue, it's not really in your best interest to go around referring to yourself as revered one. It sends the wrong message. So Octavian, Augustus, whatever, requested that in practice he be called simply Princeps, or First Citizen. Simple, classy, unpretentious. As soon as the power-sharing agreement was reached with the Senate, Augustus decided to leave town for a while and tour his new provinces. He was acutely aware of the effect he had on the people in general, and the Senate in particular. One of his overarching goals through this early period of his reign was to undercut the Senate's real authority while simultaneously building it back up into an organization with some prestige. If he remained in Rome, he would be a constant reminder that, you know what, the Senate is just a powerless social club. By absenting himself from the capital, he allowed the Senate a degree of autonomy that went a long way towards rebuilding their bruised egos. But make no mistake about it, it was about building back up their egos, not their real power. Augustus first went to Gaul, where years of Roman neglect had reduced the province to somewhere between organized revolt and outright anarchy. It did not take long, though, for the steadying hand of mighty Caesar to put all the tribes conquered by his uncle back on their best behavior. So from Gaul, he traveled to Spain, where the situation was just as chaotic, but this time, the natives were not simply awed by the power of Caesar. Even though Hispania had been one of the first overseas territories claimed by Rome back during the Punic Wars, the local Spanish had never really taken to foreign rule, and were, in many places, subjects in name only. Augustus had a mind to put a stop to all of that once and for all. He spent the next few years in Spain, but as was so often the case, for most of the time he was not leading troops in battle, but rather recovering from a severe illness that overtook him not long after crossing the Pyrenees. The early going of the pacification campaign had proved to be full of false starts and frustrating engagements with guerrilla fighters, and as usual, the stress of the hard campaign weakened Augustus's immune system, and he was forced to retire from the field. While he recovered beside the mountain springs in the Pyrenees, his lieutenants continued the fight and eventually brought it to a successful conclusion. Spain was, at least for now, under firm Roman control, or perhaps more accurately, under firm Augustan control. The severity of the illness which befell Augustus in Spain, which laid him up for at least a year, focused his attention more acutely on the problem of succession. If an heir was not solidly in place, the death of the princeps would plunge the Roman world back into civil war. To that end, Augustus bucked his wife's usually persuasive advice and continued to hone in on his nephew Marcellus rather than Livia's son Tiberius as his heir apparent. In 28 BC, Augustus arranged for Marcellus to marry his own daughter Julia, leaving no doubt as to who he felt should take over when he died. I should point out here that to the staunchly patriarchal Romans, familial bonds followed from the men and the men alone. So Julia and Marcellus, though they were first cousins by blood, were not thought to have entered into anything resembling an untoward incestual marriage. Julia was the daughter of Augustus, Marcellus the son of Gaius Claudius Marcellus. When it came to marriage, Octavia's relation to Augustus did not matter at all. In addition to the bonds of marriage that now tied Marcellus to Augustus, the princeps arranged for the passage of special legislation granting his nephew-slash-son-in-law the right to be exempted from traditional age requirements for holding office. With life-threatening illnesses always knocking at the door, it was important to bring Marcellus into public life as quickly as possible, not just to give him the experience he would need if he was going to be an able governor, but to introduce him to the Roman people. Augustus made sure that the 21-year-old would be elected aedile for 23 BC. From this office, which you will recall was in charge of public games, Marcellus would be able to throw lavish festivities that were bound to make him extremely popular with the common man. With Augustus bankrolling everything, the games of Marcellus promised to be a spectacle of unprecedented proportions. Augustus returned to Rome in 24 BC to oversee his nephew's emergence onto the public stage. But before he could preside over that happy event, he was treated to a tragic falling out with Maecenas. At some point during the year, a plot against Augustus was either uncovered or invented, depending on who you talk to. And among those implicated was one of the consuls for the year, Aulus Terentius Varro Murena. Murena just so happened to be Maecenas' brother-in-law, and when Maecenas came home and discussed the uncovered plot with his wife, she quickly warned her brother to flee the city. When Augustus found out about the breach in trust, the relationship between the two men was altered forever. While Maecenas continued to support the regime, he was out of the inner circle for good, a casualty of high-stakes politics. 23 BC would prove to be a watershed year for the empire. It was a year that showed just how quickly fate could wreak havoc on the carefully laid plans of men. Just as Marcellus was stepping into the office of aedile, Augustus became deathly ill. This time, his sickness was so bad that most everyone, including Augustus himself, did not believe he would survive. Consumed by what scholars now believe was typhoid fever, Augustus was faced with a difficult choice. He had planned for Marcellus to succeed him, but the young man was simply not experienced enough yet to take over. So Augustus turned to the man who had stood by his side all these years, who, though not technically a blood relative, was still his brother in all things, Marcus Agrippa. In Agrippa, Augustus could be sure he was leaving the empire in competent hands, a man who would rule wisely until Marcellus was ready to share in the burdens of state. Everything was arranged, and Agrippa was prepared to confidently step into the power vacuum his old friend was about to leave behind, when suddenly, due to some inventive treatment by his creative doctor, Augustus recovered. Over the course of the illness, though, it became apparent that the Senate was more than ready for Augustus to die and Agrippa to take over. Though he had tried mightily not to step on senatorial toes, Augustus couldn't help but secretly butt into provinces over which he had no authority. Even more emotionally important, though, Augustus's never-ending succession of consulships was creating a logjam of men vying for the year's one remaining slot. Men who were denied access to the high office year after year were becoming embittered, and when they visited him on his deathbed, he could see that they were ready for him to go. Octavian could now see plainly that the popularity of his regime was not what he had hoped it would be. It was time to amend the settlements of 27 BC. The first step he took was to resign the consulship on July the 1st, 23 BC, a day which would go down in history as the date Augustus himself marked the official beginning of his imperial reign. In return for this concession, he had arranged to be named tribune in perpetuity, an ingeniously simple maneuver that allowed him to abandon the consulship without actually giving up any power. A tribune, you recall, has the right to attend senatorial sessions, propose legislation, and veto legislation. Is there really anything else that a despotic ruler needs to control the empire? Well, actually there is. While Augustus was supremely powerful in his own provinces, when it came to the senatorial provinces, or Italy itself, he was left awkwardly without any real legal authority. So he had the Senate award him what amounted to at-large proconsular authority. From here on out, whatever province he was in, Augustus would have the last word on everything. Having been granted all these prerogatives, however, prerogatives which would form the legal basis for the rest of his reign, Augustus was smart enough not to indulge in them. When it came to provincial administration, he usually deferred to the local governor, and when it came to legislation, he neither personally proposed many bills nor broke out the veto stamp very often. This was all possible because he had signaled behind the scenes how he wanted things to go, of course. But still, by avoiding public displays of power whenever possible, he left everyone feeling like they at least had some say in the matter. Sure, Augustus controls everything, but it's not like he's some crazy tyrant. The successors of Augustus would have done well to study exactly how Rome's first emperor managed to reign for over 40 years, while they were usually assassinated after just a few years at the helm. The final piece of the so-called second constitutional settlement was the elevation of Agrippa to political heights almost as high as Augustus himself. It was clear that the Senate felt more comfortable with Agrippa holding some kind of formal power, and Augustus was obliged to agree. Granted similar at-large proconsular authority himself, Agrippa had now become something of a co-emperor. At this point, there is some disagreement over what happened next. What we know is that Agrippa left Rome and set up a base of operations on the island of Samos. What is unclear is why exactly he did so. In the account offered by Suetonius, Agrippa was sent into exile by Augustus because the latter was concerned his old general's growing power would interfere with his planned elevation of Marcellus. But by another account, Agrippa was sent east because he was the only one Augustus could really trust to look after his interests there. The role that Agrippa would subsequently play in the negotiations with the Parthians over the recovery of Crassus's lost legionary standards seems to point to the second reading. In the end, of course, whether or not Agrippa was getting in the way of Marcellus or not proved to be a moot point. At the end of 23 BC, with his successful year in the aedileship winding down, Marcellus became sick and suddenly died after a brief illness. This threw Augustus's plans into complete disarray and sent his sister Octavia into mourning for the rest of her life. Suddenly left without an acceptable heir, the status and rank of Agrippa now loomed large. As he had so many times before, Augustus turned to Maecenas for advice. Maecenas thought about the matter for a bit, and then told Augustus, "Well, you have made Agrippa so powerful that he now must either become your son-in-law or be killed." And that was how Agrippa officially joined the Julio-Claudian dynasty. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 53, Reigning Supreme. Octavian had transformed himself into Caesar Augustus by skillfully using the mechanisms and rhetoric of the Republic to carve out an infallible little niche for himself. Where Julius Caesar had made bold and inflammatory declarations about how obsolete Republican institutions were, Augustus was careful to never admit publicly what he was really up to. This was all about restoring the Republic, he would say. This is not about some personal power grab. It was all a charade, of course, but there was much to be gained by keeping the charade going. For example, not being stabbed to death on the floor of the Senate. But before we get going on the next few years of Augustan rule, I have to start this week by correcting what I said about the Pantheon last week. I'm not sure how exactly I managed to swing and miss so badly on my facts, but I did, so let's set things right. The Pantheon was indeed first built by Agrippa in 28 BC, and subsequently gutted by a fire in 80 AD. But when it was rebuilt in 126 AD, the construction was overseen by the Emperor Hadrian, not the Emperor Trajan, who had, of course, died in 117. And the blueprints were not set to Agrippa's original specifications, but rather new plans were drawn up that some have attributed to Hadrian himself, who was a big fan of architecture, but most likely simply came from his staff architects who were engaged in multiple urban renewal projects initiated by the emperor. The dome, which is the Pantheon's most famous attribute, was a product of Hadrian's later Pantheon. Agrippa's original version did not feature this most famous architectural achievement. I completely misread and misinterpreted the source material when I was taking notes for last week's episode, and as a result, completely face-planted for about 40 seconds there. Ugly business that I hope we can all put behind us. Okay, so by 23 BC, Augustus had worked out about 90% of the legalities for his long reign over the Roman Empire. There were still a few loose ends that needed to be cleared up over the next decade, though. Lepidus, for example, was still alive and serving as Pontifex Maximus, so Augustus was as of yet unable to assimilate that all-important religious position into his pile of honors. Plus, as much as his new proconsular imperium granted him preeminence in the provinces, Italy itself had always been treated differently under Roman law. So technically, Augustus had no right to command the 5,400 or so Praetorian guardsmen he had stationed in and around Rome. But other than those few outliers, Augustus was past the stage in his career where he was consolidating his power. Now it was simply time to reign supreme. Ironically, one of the first early crises of his de facto dictatorship did not lead to pressure for him to abdicate the throne and revive the republic, but rather it led to pressure from the masses for him to set aside this de facto business and formally become dictator for life. The people had never been happy with the sloppy and corrupt oligarchy that had ruled them for centuries and saw no reason to mince words with the Senate now that Augustus was in charge. So, when a grain shortage rocked the city after Italian farms were crippled by plague, the common citizens rioted and called for Augustus to be named dictator. They had no faith that the Senate would be able to solve their problems. Only the princeps could see them through the trouble. But Augustus, knowing that publicly embracing absolute power would alienate the Senate, refused the honor. After telling the people that the abolition of the office of dictator, decreed by Mark Antony in the wake of Julius Caesar's assassination, was still in effect, and that he would rather be stabbed in the throat than assume that office, they were forced to relent. The incident highlights the counterintuitive notion that when it came to Augustus's relationship with common Romans, their problem with him was not that he had seized too much power, but that he had not seized enough. In the years after the constitutional settlement of 23 BC, Augustus focused his attention first on foreign affairs. He switched places with his co-regent Marcus Agrippa, sending his old friend into Spain to keep an eye on things in the west, while the princeps himself traveled to the east. His foremost concern was Roman relations with the Parthian Empire. Reviewing the disastrous campaigns of Crassus and Antony, Augustus determined that there was no productive angle in continuing to view Parthia as a territory ripe for imperial expansion. It was time to come to terms with the Parthians and embrace a new policy of mutual coexistence. But by no means had Augustus forgotten the legionary standards still displayed as trophies in the Parthian court. Any deal would have to begin with the return of Rome's lost honor. But it was not enough to simply say, "Give us back the standards and we'll leave you alone." After easily repelling two massive Roman invasions, the Parthians felt pretty good about their position. Plus, there was now a pro-Parthian monarch on the throne in Armenia. Unless the Romans somehow managed to regain control of Armenia, the Parthians really had nothing to worry about. So Augustus set about reestablishing control of Armenia. To lead the campaign into that all-important buffer state set for 20 BC, Augustus chose his 22-year-old stepson Tiberius. It was time for the young man to get his feet wet and introduce the world to an important new cog in Augustus's dynastic machine. But while Tiberius would ultimately prove to be a highly effective military commander, he didn't have much of a chance to prove it in Armenia this time around. While the legions marched to the border, a native revolt erupted that deposed the sitting monarch. All that was left for Tiberius to do was crown the handpicked Roman successor. With Armenia back under Roman influence, and Augustus ordering the legions stationed in Syria out on all sorts of showy maneuvers, the Roman signals coming into Parthia were clear. You better watch out, because you don't know what we're going to do next. Augustus parlayed these shows of force into a sit-down with the king of Parthia. Now, the princeps had no interest in actually entangling Rome in a war with Parthia, but as long as they didn't know that, he bargained from a position of strength. Not willing to risk that Rome was bluffing, the king of Parthia relented to Augustus's diplomatic overtures and agreed to return the legionary standards, along with Roman prisoners taken over the years, in exchange for a lasting peace. The loss of the standards had eaten at Rome's heart for more than 30 years, and when they were finally brought back to Rome, the people celebrated as if a great military victory had just been won. For the rest of his life, Augustus considered the diplomatic return of the legionary eagles one of the great highlights of his career. With the eastern frontier now secure, Augustus returned to Rome and set his sights on domestic concerns. As I've mentioned a few times, Augustus was not interested in power simply for the comfort and prestige that it would afford him. Rather, he had big plans for reforming the empire. And he didn't confine his vision to public concerns, like how the Senate operated or how the provinces were administered. He was also interested in promoting what he considered to be healthful private relations as well. So, heads up, Caesar Augustus is coming to a bedroom near you. But before he started ruffling everyone's feathers by, say, outlawing adultery, Augustus needed to make sure that he was well protected from physical abuse. So, in 19 BC, he had the Senate officially acknowledge that when they had granted him at-large proconsular authority, they had by no means meant to exclude Italy from the list of territories over which Augustus held imperium. This gave him the legal cover he needed to command the Praetorian guardsmen he had stationed around the city. I will have much more to say about the Praetorians as we move forward, as they will soon establish themselves as the gravitational center of imperial politics. But for now, let me just note that where once it had been illegal to command troops on the home peninsula, it was now the prerogative of the emperor to do so. With his physical person protected, Augustus set about his great project of meddling in everyone's affairs. His first target was the Senate. Having been thwarted in his last attempt at reforming the ancient body, the princeps tried a different tact. His main problem was not that the Senate existed or that it wielded too much power. No, his problem was that it was way too big. Augustus had every intention of delegating assignments to the Senate, but with over 1,000 members, it was simply too large to work as an effective administrative body. If he was ever going to achieve his larger goal of improving governance of the empire, he needed to get the Senate down to a more manageable size. Membership of the Senate was, among other things, predicated on wealth requirements. So rather than going through the rolls and purging specific members, which had failed miserably the last time he tried it, Augustus simply jacked up the minimum income required for admittance. He was trying to get the total number down to a manageable 300, but his attempts again proved futile. After much complaining, fraud, and special exemptions, the Senate wound up changing very little in composition. So Augustus tried a third strategy, which proved to be a fairly workable one in practice. He formed a working group of 30 members representing the quaestors, praetors, and consuls for the year, along with a rotating group of notable senators. Legislation and proposals would be hashed out in the working group, and then their recommendations would guide the rest of the Senate. But Augustus himself was the only permanent member of the committee, meant that his hand guided the Senate's guiding hand. It was not a perfect solution, but it kept his reforms from getting bogged down in the morass of open debate. Augustus then turned his attention to matters of imperial administration. One of the glaring weaknesses of the previous Republican administration was that there was no static bureaucracy in place. Former consuls and praetors were assigned to run a province for a year, and then they were replaced by some other incoming official. As I noted in the episode on Julius Caesar's first consulship, it was a system that led to rank corruption and abuse. The Lex Julia had gone a long way towards reining in the worst of the offenders, but it was still a grossly inefficient system. So, in addition to passing supplementary anti-bribery laws, Augustus began building a permanent civil service, the ranks of which would be filled by slaves and freedmen. At all levels of government, out in the provinces, in the heart of Rome itself, up and down the line, competent slaves and ex-slaves began forming permanent support staffs for their ever-changing political appointee bosses. This new system was a great success. It not only kept the political appointees happy, they were given cushy jobs with nice salaries and little real responsibility, but it also introduced a degree of professionalism to state administration that had never before existed. Had Augustus not instituted these reforms, it is unlikely that the empire would have lasted for as long as it did. Augustus was also aware that one of the great challenges facing any large-scale empire was timely communication. The decision-makers in Rome couldn't be expected to respond effectively to developing situations abroad when it took months for word of said developing situation to reach them. Augustus pushed for other wealthy Romans to join him in improving the communications infrastructure of the empire. In the days before fiber optics and cable lines, this basically meant better roads and more horse relay stations. Augustus encouraged other wealthy Romans to join him in improving the system, but either because he was loath to wield his power like a bludgeon, or because he wasn't quite as powerful as he liked to make out, when other potential patrons dragged their feet, he let them off the hook and footed the bill himself. It is hard to overstate how wealthy Augustus was at this point, or how important that wealth was. Right alongside his command of the legions, the personal fortune he controlled was the foundation of his rule. Having built on the massive inheritance he received from Julius Caesar by first annexing Egypt and then taking control of the imperial provinces, Augustus was now by far the richest man in the empire. His wealth allowed him to do things like personally underwrite infrastructure projects that otherwise would not have gotten off the ground, say an improved communications network, which greatly enhanced his prestige with the people. This new road is not brought to you by the slow-moving, self-absorbed Senate, but rather by Augustus, the man who gets things done. Who would you rather support, the guy who's funding aqueduct expansion, or the do-nothings in the Senate who were, well, doing nothing? Augustus invested lavishly and wisely in his empire, and the people loved him for it. Money may not buy you happiness, but it will buy you control of a multinational Mediterranean empire. In 18 BC, Augustus embarked on perhaps his most controversial reform programs. A conservative at heart, the princeps was appalled by what he saw as the decline of Roman morality. He joined with other social critics who abhorred the indulgent excesses of modern Rome. Gone were the days of rigorous discipline and austerity, replaced by an atmosphere of sensuous permissiveness and conspicuous luxury. The strict Roman ethic that had conquered the world was pushed aside. Now, men and women simply wanted to enjoy the fruits of the empire that their forefathers had won for them. In the eyes of Augustus, Rome was in danger of losing what it had won if something was not done to bring back traditional virtue. Augustus believed that the heart of the problem was the breakdown in the family structure. He believed, not without reason, that Rome had been built on the back of strong families. The paterfamilias, who rears a brood of swarthy Roman children, who, if they were boys, grew to fill the ranks of the legions, and if they're girls, grew up to make more Roman boys. That was how they'd come back from the disaster after Cannae. 50,000 dead in a single day? Tragic, yes, but there's more where that came from. So, when Augustus took the census and realized that birth rates were on the decline, he began to worry about the next Cannae. Would Rome ever be able to recover if there were not any true Romans left? He began investigating the problem and soon came to realize that the issue was not that there was some epidemic of infertility or infant mortality. Rather, men and women were simply choosing not to have children. Children were a pain, so why waste time with them? It seems that everyone was pursuing their own immediate pleasures at the expense of the next generation, and possibly at the expense of the whole empire. So Augustus created incentives to encourage large families. Having one child meant that a man could stand for office a year before he was technically eligible. A man who sired three sons could expect multiple legal privileges for his contributions to the state. It goes without saying that Fred McMurray would have been a very well-respected man in Augustan Rome. But beyond concerns about children, Augustus was also distressed by what he saw as the degradation of marriage. In the past, a man and a woman married and were faithful to one another. Now, though, adultery ran so rampant that no one even batted an eye about it anymore. In fact, many men, failing to see the point of even maintaining pretenses, simply avoided getting married altogether. To Augustus, this persistent embrace of immorality was dangerously eroding Roman virtue. All that self-indulgence was simply not compatible with the self-sacrifice that the state required. A man and a woman get married, and they remain faithful. That was how it was supposed to go. So Augustus implemented penalties that hit unmarried men and women hard. The goal was to make single life so unbearable that married life seemed like a reprieve. Once he had everyone locked up in a formal marriage, he went ahead and outlawed adultery. No longer simply a matter of personal honor, cheating on a spouse became an offense against the state. In certain cases, the penalty for a woman caught cheating was actually death. Harsh? Yes. Did it work? Well, no, not really. It was hard for anyone to take the law too seriously when it was Augustus who was wagging his finger. The princeps had a well-earned reputation for straying from his wife, with slaves, with young women, with married women, with anyone who caught his eye, really. The massive hypocrisy of the draconian adultery law was not lost on anyone, and so it was taken with a grain of salt. Not that the laws didn't sometimes lead to banishment and death, but just that no one really went out of their way to inform on anyone, so most people wound up not getting caught. In the end, the Augustan morality laws did little to change anyone's behavior, but he refused to give up on them. Indeed, Augustus's peculiar obsession with adultery would eventually cost him both his daughter and his granddaughter. But believing he had set his people back on a more virtuous path, Augustus returned to his greater imperial ambitions. Unlike his uncle, who invaded Gaul because basically it was there, and died with plans to invade Parthia sitting on his desk, Augustus did not have foreign conquest in his heart. He was not really interested in winning huge new swaths of territory for the empire. In fact, from his vantage point at the very pinnacle of the state, Augustus was perhaps the only one who could see the truth. The empire was big enough. He, of course, did not let on to the fact that he was coming to believe that the empire had reached its greatest manageable extent. Because for all its long history, Rome had been forever expanding, and most believed that like a shark, if they ever stopped moving, they would die. For all his radical reforms, the idea that Rome should stop expanding was perhaps the most radical, and so he played his cards on that account very close to his chest. But I'm actually getting a little ahead of myself. While Augustus certainly believed that the empire would soon be as big as it would ever need to be, he also believed that it wasn't quite there yet. When Augustus surveyed the empire, he could see that on the west it was bordered by the Atlantic Ocean, to the south it was bordered by the Sahara Desert, in the east it was bordered by the Parthian Empire. On all three sides, Rome was protected by natural boundaries or formal treaties with civilized neighbors. But in the north was an altogether different animal. In the east, the northern border was simply an ill-defined frontier above Greece that offered no natural protection to anybody. In the west, Rome controlled Gaul up until the banks of the Rhine, but beyond that lay the anarchy of Germania. This was all totally unacceptable to Augustus. He believed that if something could be done to secure the northern frontier, a Mediterranean empire centered in Rome could continue indefinitely. In the east, Augustus had his eye on the Danube River as the natural northern border for the empire. The long, broad river would be easy to defend, and most importantly, if Rome controlled all the country up to its southern banks, there would be a territorial buffer between Italy and the lawless lands beyond. In the west, Augustus identified the Elbe River as his preferred border. If he could properly garrison the Elbe and the Danube, Rome would have a secure natural border from the North Sea to the Black Sea, and he could go to his grave knowing that he was leaving behind a stable empire that could last forever. The process of establishing new eternal borders in the north, though, did not begin in Germania or Illyricum. It actually began much closer to home. Augustus decided that before he could think about pushing the borders of the empire northward, that he would need to plug the one glaring hole of Roman domination over Western Europe, the Alps. For all they had conquered in all their years of expansion, Rome had never actually nailed down the troublesome mountain tribes in their own backyard. Augustus aimed to put a stop to this embarrassment once and for all. To oversee the operation, he chose once again to elevate Tiberius, who might get a chance to actually fight a battle this time around. Joining Tiberius as a co-general would be his younger brother Drusus. Augustus wanted to make sure that whatever glory was won in the Alps and in his planned future campaigns along the Danube and in Germania, that it was all kept in the family. Augustus knew that the greatest and most likely threat to his rule would come from an independent general winning great battles for Rome all on his own. So Augustus was careful to always give overall command of a campaign he initiated to someone he could trust not to turn against him. In practice, this meant members of his own family. So even though his stepsons were in their early 20s, much younger than your average Roman general, they were still put in command. It was just a happy coincidence, really, that they turned out to be highly effective leaders. I'm going to leave it there for this week. Next time, we'll dig into the campaigns of Tiberius and Drusus as they attempt to implement the vision laid out by their stepfather of pushing the borders of the empire to the Danube and Elbe, respectively. Next week will also mark a transition period for Augustus personally, as the old friends who had advised him and guided him for his entire career begin to die off, leaving the princeps alone at the top, fervently trying to protect his legacy in the face of one cruel twist of fate after another. But before we go, I want to throw one other thing out there. I've been approached about having the show sponsored by Audible.com. The deal would involve me reading some ad copy and directing you, my faithful listeners, to visit their fine website in exchange for giving me some money. The History of Rome has always been ad-free, and I like it that way, but I'll admit I am intrigued by the idea. Podcasting is something I enjoy immensely, and any hypothetical plan to take this from something I do in my spare time to something I actually do to draw an income involves advertising of some kind or another. So basically, I want to know what you all think. Should I take the plunge, or will it turn you off? My first priority is maintaining the integrity of the show, so if it turns out to be too intrusive, I will cut it off immediately, but I don't know. Let me know what you think in the comments at thehistoryofrome.typepad.com, or drop me an email. We're all in this together, so I figure we'll make it a group decision. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 54, All in the Family. Before we get started, I just want to thank everyone for their feedback on the sponsorship issue. Based on the comments, it looks like ads will be a go. I'm not sure exactly when they're going to start, but I promise not to let it get in the way of anything, and the content itself won't change a bit. When we left off last week, Augustus had set his sights on clearing out the last pockets of resistance to Roman rule within the existent boundaries of the empire, before setting out to push those boundaries northwest to the Danube and Elbe rivers. Tiberius and his younger brother Drusus, both in their early 20s, had been put in charge of the initial phase, pacifying the independent tribes living in and around the Alps. As I mentioned at the end of last week, it was important that Augustus elevate his stepsons to prominence as quickly as possible. The princeps' health had always been a concern, and even though he wound up living well into his 70s, the specter of sudden death always loomed large in his mind. Agrippa had thus far served admirably as a backstop in case Augustus were to die, but, let's face it, he was growing old as quickly as Augustus was. A new generation would have to be ready to step forward if and when the princeps died. It is worth pointing out, though, that as much as selfishness contributed to Augustus's promotion of his stepsons because he wanted power to remain within the family, he also had his eye firmly on the public good. By having a well-established succession plan in place, Augustus could die knowing that when he did, it would not plunge his people back into immediate civil war. But just as Agrippa had been a necessary stand-in when true descendants of Augustus were unavailable, Tiberius and Drusus were now being set up to play much the same role. Though Augustus liked and trusted his stepsons, he was still biased towards passing power to a blood relative. It's almost as if the claim that he was not setting up a monarchy dominated by a royal family was completely bogus. The temporary status of Tiberius and Drusus as heirs apparent became clear once Agrippa and Julia's new family began to grow. After marrying his best friend to his only daughter in 21 BC, Augustus kept a close eye on the new couple, hoping they would produce a long-term solution to his dynastic problems. It did not take long for Augustus to be greeted with the happy news that Julia had given birth to a son, Gaius, in 20 BC. More good news followed, as the marriage of Agrippa and Julia proved to be a fertile one, and year after year, they produced child after child. In 19 BC, Julia the Younger was born. In 17 BC, a second son, Lucius. 3 years later, Agrippina the Elder was born, followed in 12 BC by the final son, Agrippa Postumus, so named because he was born after the unfortunate early death of his father, which we will get to in a moment. In addition to this week's maps, which highlights the Danube provinces secured during the period, I have also posted a family tree of the Julio-Claudian dynasty. They are a tricky bunch to keep track of, because not only did they share about 3 total names between the whole lot of them, so which Agrippina are we talking about again? There was also some pretty heavy intermarriage going on. So I hope the family tree will help you sort everyone out. Keep it handy, because it should be good for about 80 more years. As I was saying, though, the births of Gaius and Lucius immediately put a sell-by date on Tiberius and Drusus. In a highly irregular move, Augustus decided to adopt the boys when they were still infants, bring them into his household, and raise them himself. There was simply too much at stake not to involve himself in every aspect of their lives and education. One of them was destined to sit on the throne. Augustus needed to make sure that they would be ready. But just because there was a planned obsolescence now built into Tiberius and Drusus, that did not mean that Augustus could simply ignore them. It would be 20 years or more before Gaius and Lucius could even begin the process of establishing public lives for themselves. Tiberius and Drusus were ready now, and with all the illnesses that had felled him over the years, Augustus knew that lasting the 20 years before his grandsons would be ready to take over was a dicey prospect at best. Plus, the ancient world being what it was, there was no guarantee that Gaius and Lucius would even survive childhood. It was best to keep as many irons in the fire as possible. So on the off chance that either Tiberius or Drusus was indeed destined to succeed him to the throne, Augustus made sure that everything stayed in the tight family he was building. So in 19 BC, he had Tiberius marry Vipsania, the daughter of Marcus Agrippa by his first wife, and not long after, Drusus married Antonia, the daughter of Augustus's sister Octavia, and, ironically enough, Mark Antony. Both marriages were happy ones, though in the case of Tiberius, it was this very happiness that would open up a rift with Augustus that would be the hallmark of their future relationship with each other. In 17 BC, Augustus began to set the stage for his imperial expansion. That year, one of his generals in Gaul lost a minor battle to some Germanic tribes. Rather than letting the incident pass without notice, Augustus saw his opportunity to open up legal war in Germania. Just as is the case with most every civilized country across history, Rome never just declared war. Hostilities were only opened once Rome or one of their allied kingdoms was attacked. It was very important to the Roman sense of themselves that they only entered into just wars of self-defense. In theory, this meant that they were always on strong moral footing when they marched off to war, but in practice, this meant that they simply seized on the flimsiest pretext to launch a campaign. Now Augustus had his flimsy pretext. He traveled himself to Gaul and began reorganizing the legions there to prepare them for what would no doubt be a difficult push across the Rhine River to the banks of the Elbe. The princeps would remain in the province for a good 3 years, keeping himself within easy reach of all the campaigns he had initiated. The first major push, as I said at the end of last week, was Tiberius and Drusus' invasion of what would become the province of Raetia, which covered modern-day Switzerland and part of Austria. In the single summer of 15 BC, the two brothers ruthlessly prosecuted a war of pacification against the tribes living there. The causus belli for the invasion, I should note, was some reported ill treatment of Roman citizens passing through the territory. Flimsy pretexts, I has them. Rather than being satisfied with simply beating the tribes on the battlefield and turning them into taxpayers, the two brothers decided that the best way to ensure the mountainous region remained safe for Roman travelers was to initiate a mass deportation of the men. Those who weren't sold into slavery were marched at spear point off their land. Women, children, and old men were left behind to keep the region nominally populated, but completely defenseless. Neighboring Raetia, incorporating the rest of modern Austria, was the recently consolidated, if still unofficial, province of Noricum. The tribes there had been friends of Rome since at least 170 BC, and had actually been important allies of Julius Caesar during his civil wars against the Senate. In 16 BC, all Augustus had to do was order a proconsul in to occupy the land. The formal annexation of all the land south of the Danube was well underway. With Roman intentions obvious, the recently passive tribes inhabiting Pannonia rose up against encroachment. They had been beaten soundly by Augustus during his Illyrian campaigns 20 years earlier, but their territory had not been officially incorporated into the empire. The fiercely independent Pannonian tribes could barely stand unofficial servitude, so there was no way they were going to be able to stand official servitude. And with the legions on the march, that sure looked like what they were headed for. But that fierce independence would ironically sow the seeds for their loss of it, because not only were they predisposed to standing apart from Rome, they were also predisposed to standing apart from each other. Unable to establish a united front, the tribes were easily picked off one by one. That is not to say that the conquest of Pannonia took place overnight, as the conquest of Raetia basically had, but just to say that the outcome was never really in doubt. In 13 BC, the 29-year-old Tiberius served as consul for the first time, obviously long before he should have qualified for that office. Lifting age restrictions for his possible heirs was one of Augustus's favorite tricks to give them a leg up on the competition. When his year in the consulship was done, Tiberius would qualify for any number of proconsulships in the provinces, where he could continue to grow his power and prestige. All the while, his peers would be hoping against hope to nail down that first quaestorship. 13 BC also marked, finally, the passing of Marcus Lepidus. The old triumvir had managed to last another 25 years living in comfortable obscurity after being booted from the triumvirate in 36 BC. The one concession Augustus had allowed Lepidus when the latter left the public stage was allowing him to remain as Pontifex Maximus, an office he had held since the death of Julius Caesar. When Lepidus died, Augustus naturally assumed the high priesthood. Now, the princeps was the official head of all three branches of Roman public life, the church, the state, and the military. At the end of the year, with operations in Pannonia going well but not perfectly, Augustus sent in Marcus Agrippa to bring the annexation to a speedy conclusion. Eager to get started, Agrippa immediately set sail for the Balkans and spent the winter there, planning the next summer's campaign. But it was a campaign that he would not live to see. Suffering from a number of nagging ailments, Agrippa caught sick and was forced to return home in March of 12 BC. But, landing in Brundisium, he took a turn for the worse. Messengers raced to Rome to deliver the news to Augustus, who dropped what he was doing and rushed to Brundisium, but by the time he got there it was too late. Marcus Agrippa was dead. It would be difficult to overstate what a blow this was. Agrippa was basically the reason Augustus had gotten anywhere in life. The inherited name of Julius Caesar was obviously the catalyst for his rise, and the savvy advice of Maecenas helped him pick his way through the treacherous world of Roman politics. But it would all have been for naught without victories on the battlefield, and all of Augustus's most important victories, against first Sextus Pompey and then Mark Antony, had been won by Agrippa. The death of the great general at age 51 was a harsh reminder that while he was now all-powerful, Augustus never really had been able to do it alone. The question of what would happen the next time a key military victory was required must have weighed heavy on Augustus's mind, because not only had he been able to trust Agrippa to win the battle, but he could also trust Agrippa not to betray him afterwards. The next great battle, if such a thing occurred, would be fraught with danger for the regime. Defeat would mean a loss of legitimacy, while victory would mean a new rival for power. The death of Agrippa was bad news for Augustus, no matter which way he sliced it. But that did not mean Augustus was going to simply cash in his chips or linger too long over the death of his friend. After escorting Agrippa's body back to Rome, Augustus placed the remains in his own recently constructed mausoleum, so at least in death, the two friends would be reunited. But when he closed the doors on the tomb, it was time to move on. The key question was what to do with his now twice-widowed daughter, Julia. He mulled over, but then dismissed the idea of marrying her to an ally outside the family. No, Augustus wanted to keep everything in a nice, tight little bundle, so he settled on marrying her to Tiberius. The only problem was that Tiberius was happily married to Vipsania, and he had no desire to marry the woman who had so recently been his stepmother-in-law. He and Vipsania had already produced a healthy son named Nero Claudius Drusus, named unusually after his uncle rather than Tiberius himself, as was the custom. But when Augustus made up his mind, he made up everybody's mind. Tiberius was forced to divorce Vipsania and marry Julia. The bitterness over the incident grew slowly in Tiberius, sparked at first simply by his longing for Vipsania, but then nursed into a full-blown fiery rage when he really got to know his new wife. The problem was that the two were simply not compatible. Tiberius was conservative, thoughtful, and at times an admittedly humorless man. He was smart, talented, and ambitious, but embraced none of the flamboyance that had come to mark Julia's personality. As the only daughter of Augustus, Julia had been raised in a pampered world of wealth and privilege. But now that she was grown up, she was not daddy's little girl anymore. She was now simply a pawn in her father's dynastic games. Never one to consider his daughter's feelings, Augustus married her off as was politically expedient, and then took her sons Gaius and Lucius away at the first opportunity. In response, Julia began to act out against her father's obsession with traditional morality and proceeded to carry on affairs with Rome's leading men, essentially making a fool out of Augustus behind his moralizing back. Tiberius stepped into the situation and soon found himself playing the cuckold. But as much as Tiberius disdained his new wife, it seems that Julia was no great fan of Tiberius's either. She even sent a letter to her father through an intermediary denouncing Tiberius as unworthy of her hand in marriage and beneath her. After their only child died in infancy, Tiberius seems to have renounced marital relations with Julia, not that she cared. After Agrippa died, Tiberius inherited not just the general's widow, but also his command in Pannonia. Drusus, meanwhile, was placed in charge of the armies of the Rhine, and in contrast to Tiberius's unhappy private life, found his own family a source of great joy. His marriage to Antonia was a happy one and produced three children, each destined for a life in the public eye. Drusus returned the compliment Tiberius had paid him by naming his own eldest son, born in either 16 or 15 BC, Nero Claudius Tiberius. Of course, we know the boy today by the agnomen he inherited from his father, Germanicus. Filling out the family was Julia Livilla, born in 13 BC, and the reversely named Tiberius Claudius Nero, born in 10 BC. Obviously, the Romans were not much for unique naming, so from here on out, I'll be referring to them as Germanicus, Livilla, and Claudius, respectively. And in case you didn't already know, yes, that Claudius. The young family was the toast of the Roman world. Drusus, unlike his sad sack and socially awkward older brother, was outgoing and universally popular. Antonia herself soon joined the auspicious ranks of Cornelia Africana, mother of the Gracchi brothers, and her own mother Octavia, as a near deified paragon of womanly virtue. When Drusus died, she refused to remarry, eventually living another 5 decades without ever taking a new husband, a highly unusual state of affairs. From 11 BC to 9 BC, the two stepsons of Augustus battled their way into hostile territory. Tiberius had the easier time of it because, as I said, the tribes of Pannonia remained too disconnected to really prove a match for the legions. But Germania was a different story. The tribes there were larger, tougher, and more strategically advanced than the natives in Pannonia. Drusus was able to eventually push his armies all the way to the Elbe, but every winter he was forced to withdraw back to the safety of Gaul. When they faced Drusus in battle, the Germans usually lost, but that in no way led to anything resembling an atmosphere of conquest. Like the Romans themselves, the Germans could lose all the battles in the world and still never admit defeat. In 9 AD, a Roman general named Publius Varus would make the mistake of thinking the Germans a conquered people and lead 3 legions into a disaster that would see the Romans more or less withdraw from Germania forever. The dream of a border on the Elbe River abandoned. Disaster struck the royal family, and really that's what they were, a royal family, in the late summer of 9 BC when Drusus fell off of his horse. He had been winding down a successful year in the consulship and was preparing to take on proconsular authority and follow his brother up the chain of command. But just like that, his career and his life were cut short. The injuries he sustained from the fall likely became infected, and he was simply unable to recover. In a touching tribute to the bond shared by the brothers, Tiberius raced across 200 miles of hostile territory, accompanied by a single Gallic guide when he heard the news. Unlike Augustus racing to meet Agrippa, Tiberius was able to make it in time, but just barely. Soon after his brother's arrival, Drusus died. Tiberius led the body back to Rome and was soon joined by Augustus and Livia, who was beside herself with grief at the loss of her son. As I said, Antonia never remarried. She moved in with Augustus and Livia, and her children were raised alongside their older cousins, Gaius and Lucius. The next year brought only more bad news for Augustus. Maecenas, his longtime friend and key political advisor during the rise to power, died in October, leaving Augustus alone at the top. There is something indispensable about advisors who are around before power is won, who can speak plainly and directly without succumbing to awe. Augustus was fast running out of such men, and the two most important were now dead. Augustus, for so long the young man fighting his elders for power, was now himself the elder, surrounded by younger men whose relationship to him was inalterably colored by his supreme power. Augustus was never lonely or lacking for company, but at this point, the only person left who resembled both a friend and an equal was Livia. There was much speculation about why he remained with her after it became apparent that their marriage would never produce children. But perhaps she gave him access to an easy familiarity that he would be unable to find anywhere else. File that under pure speculation, though. With Agrippa and Drusus dead, the only man ready to step into power now, should Augustus die, was Tiberius. Probably out of consideration for this fact, Tiberius was promoted to a status not unlike that attained by Agrippa after Augustus's brush with death in 23 BC. After taking over his brother's command in Germania, he served as consul in 7 BC and was then granted the same power of the tribunate that Augustus enjoyed. Once his year in the consulship was over, Augustus had slated Tiberius to head east and oversee another intervention into Armenia, where a pro-Parthian monarch had recently ascended the throne. But Tiberius shocked everyone when he suddenly announced that he would be doing no such thing, that, in fact, he was retiring from public life for good. Historians, both ancient and modern, have puzzled over Tiberius's inexplicable retirement. Some posit that he could see plainly that he was simply a temporary placeholder, that he would be forced to step aside for Gaius and Lucius eventually, so why waste his life clearing the way for his younger stepbrothers? Others say that he actually had the teenager's best interests at heart and was removing himself from the stage so there would be no competition for the public's attention. And, of course, on a more personal level, everyone likes to point out how unhappy the marriage between Tiberius and Julia was, and that when he retired, he was retiring as much from her as he was from politics. Whatever the real reason, in 6 BC, the one man Augustus would feel comfortable turning over the empire to walked away from him. Augustus was enraged by his stepson's betrayal, and when the princeps announced Tiberius's decision to the Senate, his remarks made it very clear that he was taking the whole thing personally. But despite the heavy pressure exerted on him to reconsider, Tiberius packed his bags and sailed for Rhodes, the island he had chosen for his self-imposed exile. It's hard to tell what to make of the episode. Did Tiberius really think he was leaving public life behind, or was it all some elaborate charade designed to prove how indispensable he was? To partially answer the question, I think we can look to the fact that while Tiberius gave up formal office when he left for Rhodes, he conspicuously did not give back the at-large powers the Senate had bestowed upon him. One suspects that Tiberius was not done with politics just yet. Tiberius's announcement left Augustus in a bind. Gaius and Lucius, at this point, were only 14 and 11. If the princeps died, who would take over? Because they certainly weren't ready. Tiberius could always be returned from retirement, but this whole self-imposed exile thing would make it very difficult to arrange for a peaceful transfer of power. If Tiberius was still retired when Augustus died, other ambitious men would seize on the opportunity to lay their own claim on the throne. Since that certainly wouldn't do, Augustus was left with no other choice. He simply had to keep living. One way or the other, he would have to stay alive long enough to see Gaius and Lucius come of age and establish a place in Roman public life for themselves. Next week, fate will continue to mock Augustus's plan for a permanent dynasty. While the princeps focused on outliving the childhoods of his two grandsons, he was not prepared to outlive them completely. But when death came calling, first for Lucius and then for Gaius, the princeps could only stand by helplessly as his young heirs were stolen away from him. To make matters worse, by the time the two boys died, Augustus had already banished Julia from Rome when somebody finally told him what she had been up to all these years. With his only daughter wasting away in exile and his two prized grandsons dead, the family Augustus had worked so hard to build and protect was now in shambles. The Julian line could no longer stand on its own two feet. It would need a transfusion of blood from the Claudians to survive. Before we go, I would like to take a personal moment here, as today is Mother's Day in the United States. Mom, I know you're like three episodes behind the pace, so this won't get to you for another week or two. But wherever you are, probably trucking around the neighborhood, happy Mother's Day. I love you. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 55, Teutoburg Nightmares. When we left off last week, Augustus was overseeing the rise of his two grandsons, Gaius and Lucius, and dealing with the fallout from the sudden retirement of his stepson Tiberius in 6 BC. The next decade will bring even more hardship for the imperial family, as the fates intervened to visit every misery imaginable on the house of Caesar. But beyond the internal problems of the first family, the whole empire will soon be visited with a disaster to rival the massacre at Cannae and the Parthian annihilation of Crassus's eastern legions. Rome had spent its life expanding, always and ever outward. Augustus could already see, though, that the endless growth could not continue forever, that future generations would not be tasked with winning new territory for the empire, but rather keeping what had already been seized. But even he was not ready to be done with imperial conquest just yet. That was why the disaster in the Teutoburg Forest was such a heavy blow. Germania was supposed to be the last province the empire would ever need, but instead it was never taken. The final piece of the puzzle never put into place. Instead, the land beyond the Rhine would forever whisper in Rome's ear like the slave standing beside a conquering general in his triumphal chariot, reminding him that he is mortal. But before we get into all that, we need to unpack some more of the drama of the Julio-Claudian family, as events during these middle years of Augustus's reign will set the stage for the future path of the imperial monarchy. Augustus had always taken pains to have his family live exemplary public and private lives, to lead by example as the emperor tried to simultaneously renew the old Roman spirit while strangling off its republican roots. As I mentioned previously, the princeps was heavily invested in legislating sexual and marital relations to create a healthy environment within which to raise the new generation of Roman children. The only problem was that as hard as it was to legislate morality, it proved even harder to keep his own children and grandchildren in line. Behind Augustus's back, the House of Caesar was fast turning into a house of ill repute. Everyone knew it, everyone except the princeps himself. But in 2 BC, that all changed. After years of treating the back alleys of Rome as her personal playground, the exploits of Augustus's daughter Julia finally reached the princeps' ears. He had been kept in the dark, thinking her a paradigm of virtue, while all the while she carried on numerous affairs with men born both high and low, from the lowliest slave to men of the highest rank, including a member of the Gracchi family, and, perhaps most famously, Mark Antony's second son, Aulus. The shock of the revelation caused Augustus to perhaps overreact, but with clamping down on libertine sexual attitudes such a personal crusade for him, it is understandable that when his own daughter was revealed to be a prime contributor to the problem, that the sense of betrayal must have run deep. Deep enough, anyway, that against the advice of nearly everyone, he banished Julia from Rome and never allowed her to return. Her identified lovers were banished themselves or forced to commit suicide. The scandal rocked Rome as men of the most prominent families were suddenly exiled or killed. The common citizens of Rome were overcome with sympathy for Julia and her lovers, and when Augustus took to the streets, they begged him to allow them all to return. But he was not having it. The cold, cruel streak that had run through Augustus since the beginning resurfaced. Julia was dead to him. Still very much alive, though, were her two sons, Gaius and Lucius. Raised by the princeps himself, the two boys were growing fast into smart and capable teenagers. They were not perfect, though, and both earned reputations as haughty, self-indulgent, spoiled children. Augustus had tried mightily to prevent this from happening, but he could not watch them all the time, nor prevent Rome from lavishing them with their every desire practically from birth. But as the sons of Agrippa and the grandsons of Augustus, the princeps figured that there was enough noble, pragmatic, and talented blood running through their veins that as they matured, they would, well, mature. Even though Augustus wanted to accelerate the career paths of the two boys, there were limits to how far he would go. When Gaius was only 14, there was agitation in the streets in favor of Augustus appointing the boy consul. Augustus himself stood for the consulship that year, so he could oversee Gaius's ceremonial transition into manhood, which took place traditionally at the age of 15. Of course, the people voted overwhelmingly in favor of the princeps, but in a surprise move, they also went ahead and elected young Gaius as his colleague. Unwilling to go that far that fast, Augustus vacated the decision and announced that Gaius could serve as consul as soon as he turned 20, but not a day before. He was, after all, not even a man yet. He also promised the people that Lucius would be able to follow a similar path and slated him for a consulship when he turned 20. With Tiberius now gone, Augustus needed to get both boys up to speed as soon as possible, but he didn't want to overdo it. The fall-started campaign in Armenia, though, which Tiberius was to have spearheaded, left Augustus in another quandary regarding the rapidity of his grandson's rise. Specifically, he saw Armenia as the perfect opportunity to give Gaius command experience, but if he put the teenager in charge, would the whole thing backfire? The people were certainly ready enough to give the young heir a position of authority, but was Gaius ready to take it? Swallowing his misgivings, Augustus decided to appoint the boy to deal with the situation in the east. The situation being that the Parthians were once again meddling in Armenia, which interfered with Rome's own meddling, something Augustus could not tolerate. In 1 BC, 18-year-old Gaius went east and set up a base of operations on the island of Samos, from which he would project Rome's imperial power. Not far from Samos was, of course, the island of Rhodes, home these past 5 years to Tiberius. The melancholy stepson of Augustus, now well into middle age, seems in those 5 years to have grown disenchanted with his exile. Perhaps because he realized that he was not, after all, indispensable, or because, after Julia's affairs became known, Augustus had unilaterally declared her unhappy marriage to Tiberius void, freeing him of the woman he hated. Tiberius began to ask his stepfather for permission to return to Rome, a request Augustus refused to even consider, despite heavy lobbying from Livia. So Tiberius's exile transitioned almost overnight from self-imposed to forced. With Gaius taking on his first foreign assignment and ready to step into the consulship in 1 AD, Tiberius found himself forgotten, left to wither on Rhodes, homesick, and ignored. But we all know now that it was not Tiberius's destiny to die in obscurity. No, he was destined to succeed Augustus to the throne. So how did he get from exile back into the center of Roman power? Augustus clearly wanted nothing more to do with him, and with Gaius and Lucius progressing nicely, it would take quite a chain of events for the princeps to accept Tiberius back into his good graces. But the ancient world was a cruel and sudden place, and in the span of 18 months, Tiberius went from hated exile to heir apparent. In 2 AD, Lucius, then 19 years old and set to hold the consulship the next year, was traveling to Spain on assignment for Augustus. While he was passing through Gaul, Lucius was stricken by an illness, and before anyone could even be notified that anything was amiss, he died. Augustus was devastated. Without any sons of his own, he had raised Lucius as his own. And now, just like that, the young man Augustus had poured his heart and soul into was gone. Beyond the emotional blow, this meant that all of Augustus's hopes for a permanent Julian dynasty now rested on Gaius alone. If anything were to happen to the elder brother, Augustus did not know what he would do. A year and a half later, though, he found out. After helping resolve the situation in Armenia, which involved forging a compromise with the Parthians, whereby Rome allowed Parthia's chosen candidate to ascend to the Armenian throne, in exchange for the Parthians recognizing that Armenia was firmly in Rome's sphere of influence. Gaius was acting as a tourist in the east when news came that not everyone in Armenia was happy with the compromise. A revolt had broken out, and Gaius led the legions in to help quell the disturbances. In 4 AD, While laying siege to a small town, Gaius was wounded. The wound never healed properly, and as he traveled back to the west, the infection became worse. He died on the southern coast of Anatolia at the tender age of 24. If Augustus found the death of Lucius hard to take, the death of Gaius was absolutely devastating. The two boys he had groomed for power, who he expected to one day rule the empire, were dead. Just like that, dead. Who else could he turn to? Finally, the endless stream of letters from Tiberius would have to be opened. His requests to return from exile would have to be granted. The reality that he was now the only man alive who could succeed Augustus to the throne would have to be acknowledged. Tiberius was now once again the heir apparent. Now, I suppose this is a good time to address a rumor that has been kicking around since the days of antiquity. I speak, of course, of the Livia killed everyone theory of Roman imperial history. In this theory, Livia takes on the persona of the wicked stepmother, a familiar archetype that was well known to Roman dramatists, who, in her single-minded push to drive Tiberius into power, poisoned anyone who got in their way. First Marcellus, or Marcellus, depending on who you talk to, then Lucius, then Gaius. She arranged the banishment of Julia, and will soon enough arrange the banishment of young Agrippa Posthumus and his sister Julia the Younger. She was even accused of eliminating her own son Drusus, who was suspected of having Republican sympathies. These accusations have been around since it became clear that young Julian men in line for the throne had a habit of dying young and suddenly, but are of course given their fullest voice in the BBC miniseries I, Claudius. Having somehow gone my entire life without ever actually seeing the show, I decided to right that particular wrong and have recently been watching it with the utmost enjoyment. I, Claudius is of course awesome, and anyone who is listening to this podcast will thoroughly enjoy it, but all I can say is Robert Graves really, really didn't like Livia. She is portrayed as evil and manipulative right down to the core. I don't think there is a sympathetic moment for her in the entire series. All I can say about this is that we should remain skeptical about such portrayals. Even the Latin historians, Suetonius especially, who specialized in gossip, acknowledged that there is no proof of anything and that the rumors were likely concocted by enemies of the regime, particularly enemies of Tiberius, who wished to discredit the entire Claudian half of the Julio-Claudian dynasty. We should also keep in mind that in the ancient world, sudden death was not exactly unheard of. Disease ran rampant, and medicine was barely out of its infancy. There is no need to concoct a tale about a diabolical woman secretly assassinating her son's rivals to explain the fact that Lucius got sick and died, or that after being stabbed with a sword, Gaius' wound never healed properly, and he died. This is all to say that basically, I'm not going to go there. To me, Livia will remain a staunch promoter of her son's interests and a ruthless defender of the new imperial regime, but I will not be portraying her as the embodiment of pure malevolence. But go check out I, Claudius. Not for nothing is it regarded as some of the finest television ever produced. So, moving on. After the death of Gaius, Tiberius returned to Rome. He was quickly adopted by Augustus, and his at-large powers, which had lapsed during his exile, were renewed and extended by the Senate. As a condition of his adoption, though, Tiberius was required to adopt his now 20-year-old nephew Germanicus. With Germanicus having blood ties back to Augustus through his mother Antonia, the princeps hoped that after a temporary diversion through Tiberius, power would wind up back in the hands of a Julian. Doubly ensuring that in the future, power would remain in Julian hands, Germanicus was married to Augustus's granddaughter Agrippina. When the princeps died, Tiberius would reign by necessity, but then the family of Germanicus would take their rightful places on the throne. It was lucky that Germanicus was turning out to be such a promising young man, because the rest of his family was a disaster. Agrippa Posthumus, the last surviving son of Marcus Agrippa and Julia, had grown into a violent and cruel young man. In 7 AD, after numerous complaints and indiscretions, Augustus finally had to give up, and Posthumus was forced into exile, banished to a tiny island that was little more than a rock. The next year, Julia the Younger followed in her mother's footsteps, first into a life of moral flexibility, carrying on her own series of infamous affairs, and then exile at Augustus's orders. Rumors held, though, that she was not banished simply for immorality, but that she was also taking part in a plot against the Augustan regime. Her first husband had been executed on charges of treason, and some suppose that his wife had more than a little to do with the whole affair. Whenever his daughter or grandchildren popped up in conversation, Augustus was known to quote from the Iliad, "Ah, to have never married and childless died." Rounding out the Hall of Shame were Germanicus's sister Livilla, who will eventually commit suicide after being implicated in the murder of Tiberius's son, and his brother Claudius, a stammering idiot who everyone knew would never amount to anything. While Augustus was dealing with his internal family dramas, an external disaster shook the regime right down to its core. Over the years, between the campaigns of Drusus and the subsequent campaigns of Tiberius, the Roman grip on Germania had slowly tightened. By 7 AD, the Romans were moving with relative impunity through the country and had established alliances with numerous Germanic tribes. Bases and forts had been erected on the far side of the Rhine, and, by all accounts, it was looking like Germania would soon be formally annexed. The only problem was that despite the appearance of goodwill and friendship, the majority of German tribes had no love for Rome whatsoever, and were not going to sit by while their country was enveloped into the empire. Into this dynamic stepped two men, Publius Quintilius Varus, then governor assigned to the task of consolidating Roman control of the country, and a German chieftain known by his Latinized name, Arminius. Arminius was well trusted by the Romans and played the part of a staunch Roman ally to the hilt. He had served in the legions, leading German auxiliary forces in numerous battles, and had even been granted citizenship for his service. Varus trusted the German leader implicitly and considered him a key to bringing the Germans in line with Roman rule. But despite outward appearances, Arminius hated the Romans. His real dream was not helping Rome conquer Germania, but rather uniting the independent German tribes under his single banner and leading them to victory against the legions. For 2 years, he ostensibly advised and aided Varus in his labors, but secretly was organizing a massive resistance effort. By 9 AD, Arminius had convinced enough of his countrymen to join him that he felt strong enough to strike. But being strong enough to strike did not mean simply declaring his break from Rome and attacking in a set-piece battle. No, that would never work. The German chieftain knew from his years of serving in the legions that his fellow tribesmen were no match for Rome's armies, all things being equal. So he set about making sure that all things would not be equal. He devised a trap for the Romans and then leveraged his influence with Varus to make sure that the Roman leader walked right into it. Arminius was so trusted, in fact, that even when evidence of his intentions was brought to Varus's attention, the Roman general dismissed it as slander. But it wasn't slander. It was the truth. The trap was set for September, just as the weather was turning sour and the Romans were thinking more about holing up for the winter than dealing with a massive Germanic uprising. Arminius brought word to Varus that a revolt had broken out northwest of the main Roman camp, and that it would be best to go in with a show of force and remind the locals that their new rulers did not tolerate insurrection. So Varus led the three legions under his command, the 17th, 18th, and 19th, out of the camp, marching them northwest towards the alleged revolt. But of course, there was no uprising. Using the excuse that he was leaving to go raise more local soldiers to help Rome quell the unrest, Arminius left the Roman camp, met up with the massive army waiting to ambush the marching Romans in the Teutoburg forest. Completely unaware that anything was amiss, and believing himself far from any trouble, Varus marched his men in sloppy fashion. He declined to send out any advance scouts and allowed thousands of camp followers with their slow-moving baggage trains to travel alongside his forces. Believing his men to be in no danger, Varus also neglected to march in battle-ready order. Arminius had pointed them down a narrow and muddy road, and with heavy rain starting up, the going was slow. At a location that archaeologists have identified as just northeast of modern Osnabrück, the legions were forced to pass through a narrow strip of land cutting between a sharp hill to the south and marshland to the north. I have a map posted of what the likely site looked like that was based on a map posted by Yona Lendering of Livius.org, whose careful analysis of the battle forms the basis for most of my own recounting of the disaster. At the narrow pass, Arminius waited to ambush the Romans. The Germans had fortified a position along the slope of the southern hill, and after allowing a good portion of the Roman train to pass, launched an assault on the middle of the Roman army. Varus and his men were taken totally unaware. The army was cut in half and suffered heavy losses. An attempt was made to storm the fortified wall the Germans had erected, but to no avail. The lead group, with the Germans now behind them, either escaped or were themselves annihilated after being forced into the marshland. The other group, with Varus still in command, fought their way out of the trap and managed to build a camp just west of the ambush site. After spending a sleepless night holed up behind their hastily erected fortifications, the remaining Romans broke out the next morning and headed southwest. But having to fight their way through hordes of German tribesmen, the breakout caused significant casualties. Between the initial ambush and the morning breakout, the three legions of Varus were, by this time, essentially destroyed. No longer were they an army fighting a battle. These were survivors fighting to escape. Varus led his men southwest, probably trying to make for a Roman base situated upon the Lippa River, but they would never make it. Between the heavy woods and the heavy rains, the Romans were unable to use their archers, unable to even hold up their waterlogged shields. Arminius sent a force ahead of Varus, and the confused Romans were ambushed for a second time. Surrounded, Varus recognized that continued fighting was hopeless. The Roman governor, along with most of his remaining officers, committed suicide. Some Roman soldiers were able to slip away from these repeated ambushes and make their way to the fortress along the Lippa, but they were an insignificant minority of those who had set out with Varus in search of a non-existent revolt just days before. The 17th, 18th, and 19th legions, plus accompanying cavalry and auxiliary troops, all told accounting for some 20,000 men, had been slaughtered. The battle in the Teutoburg Forest is widely recognized as one of those earth-shattering events that alters the course of history. Perhaps in constructing a narrative about why the Romans settled on the Rhine as their chosen frontier, historians have allowed the battle to take on outsized importance. But there is no doubt that it was a monumental disaster for Rome. The 17th, 18th, and 19th legions, for example, pass now from the historical record. Their numbers never again used by any future legions, sort of like retiring the number of a beloved sports hero. Augustus was reported to have stopped shaving for months after news of the massacre reached Rome, a traditional step in the Roman mourning process. For the rest of his life, Augustus is also reported to periodically and without warning shout, "Quintilius Varus, give me back my legions." Whether there was a one-to-one relation between the battle and the cession of permanent expansion into Germania or not, the two events coincide so neatly that the formation of a legend was inevitable. 19th century German nationalists made a hero of Arminius, calling him by his German name Hermann. They built statues to him and used the battle in the Teutoburg as proof of their racist superiority over the decadent Latins they had easily defeated. In concluding his article on the battle, Jona Lendering also points out that if the slaughter in the Teutoburg did indeed cause the Romans to abandon Germany, then Arminius deserves credit for the remaining existence of both the German and English languages, both of which would have been overwhelmed by Latin had the Romans successfully annexed Germania, just as the local dialects in France and Spain were supplanted. Whether fully justified or not, the battle in the Teutoburg Forest is one of those major mileposts along the road of Roman history, and it will definitely be on the test. Now, obviously, the Romans were not ones to simply tuck tail and run. So in the aftermath of the disaster, Augustus sent Tiberius to the Rhineland to execute punitive expeditions against the Germans. Tiberius would spend the next few years marauding around the countryside, laying waste to settlements and enslaving the natives. But there was no more interest shown in establishing permanent outposts east of the Rhine. Tiberius himself, when he became emperor, never pushed for any substantial war-making in Germania, Germanicus's campaigns notwithstanding. It is likely that in the final calculation, the Romans realized that the only thing capable of unifying the disparate German tribes into a force that could actually threaten the empire was the presence of Romans on their land. By remaining west of the Rhine, the Romans gave the Germans no cause to abandon their eternal squabbling. In fact, the breakdown of German unity happened almost immediately after their greatest victory over Rome. After the Romans withdrew, Arminius sent the head of Varus to a rival chieftain to prove that together the Romans would not stand a chance against the tribes of Germania. But the rival leader simply passed the head along to Rome for burial, suspecting that Arminius was trying to make himself king and seeing no reason to allow such a thing to happen. Self-interest trumping all. Lacking unity, the Germans could no longer threaten Rome. But just to be careful, 8 full legions were forever stationed up and down the Rhine. These troops would guard the new frontier for hundreds of years, keeping Rome safe from the unconquered barbarians in Germania. There will be no episode next week, as I'll be traveling around for Memorial Day weekend. Unfortunately, the Mets blew up Randy Johnson yesterday, so he won't be going for his 300th win next Friday in Seattle, but I'll be at Safeco anyway, basking in the fading glow of the greatest left-handed pitcher in baseball history. We'll return in 2 weeks to follow Augustus's last great test, transferring power to Tiberius. Many believed that when Augustus died, the regime would die with him. But the old princeps arranged things as best he could to ensure that this wouldn't happen. The transition of power from Augustus to Tiberius was fraught with danger, but in the end, it would be pulled off without a hitch. Imperial Rome was off and running. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 56, The King is Dead, Long Live the King. Last time, we left Augustus reeling from the shocking annihilation of 3 legions in the Teutoburg Forest in 9 AD. The princeps, who was now over 70, never really recovered from the blow. The self-assuredness that had marked the regime from the beginning, a more tempered version of the audacious swagger that young Octavian had displayed, now shifted into something more cautious, more uneasy, and more paranoid. It was not just the defeat in Germania that caused the change in tone. Augustus was getting on in years and found himself handing off more and more of the day-to-day routine of empire to Tiberius, who, as we will see, was nothing if not cautious, uneasy, and paranoid. But Tiberius's influence aside, there is no doubt that the disaster in the Teutoburg Forest affected Augustus mightily. It was the first time the fates had conspired to deny the princeps what he really wanted, in this case, the full annexation of Germania. He had dealt with setbacks and disappointments and betrayals before, and perhaps a younger Augustus would have raised more troops and conquered Germania just to prove to them who was in charge. But now, he took the defeat as a sign from the gods that he was overreaching, that he asked for too much, and that it was time to pull back. Twilight was settling in on the emperor, and he knew it. After the loss in Germania, Augustus stopped thinking about expansion, and stopped thinking altogether, really, about initiating new projects. The time had come to shore up the regime, secure his legacy, and make sure that when he finally, inevitably died, that the empire would not slip into chaos. Looking out over Rome, Augustus could at least be content in the knowledge that his legacy would not be that hard to secure. Every street in the capital and every city in the provinces had been touched by his policies, his reforms, and his vision for the future of the empire. Famously announcing on his deathbed that he had found Rome a city of brick and left it a city of marble, Augustus was speaking both literally and metaphorically. Literally, his building projects had replaced many of the old crumbling facades around the city with the marble edifices we think of today when we picture ancient Rome. Augustus also left in his wake a slew of temples, baths, palaces, and aqueducts, all built in an attempt to turn the city, which was now, after all, the capital of the known world, into something that at least resembled its status. A great many of the projects, in particular a new line of aqueducts that delivered fresh water in abundance to the filthy, teeming masses, were spearheaded by Agrippa, who was not just Augustus's leader on the battlefield, but also something like his chief urban planner. At one point, Agrippa even took a step backwards on the cursus honorum, a thing not often done, just to take the office of city aedile, which had jurisdiction over the areas Agrippa and Augustus wanted to see improvements done. But it was not just the physical buildings themselves that Augustus transformed. He also inherited a jumbled mess of haphazard Republican administrative practices that left the empire ill-governed and ill-served. He had the good fortune to reign for over 40 years, so he could afford to slowly work his way through the Gordian knot of entrenched interests that protected what was theirs at the expense of anything resembling the greater good. In addition to building out a stable slave and freedman-based bureaucracy, Augustus also introduced a professional firefighting force and a professional police force to Rome for the first time. Gone now were the days where Marcus Crassus could sit outside a burning home and extort the property from frantic owners in exchange for putting out the blaze. Gone also were the private tax farmers out in the provinces. I haven't talked much about how the Romans collected their taxes up to this point, but basically it went like this. A private agency would bid for the right to collect taxes in a certain area. The winning bid paid to the Senate was the money the state received as the quote-unquote tax revenue. The business model of the tax farmer was then to go out into his province and try to raise more in taxes than he had paid to the government. There was little oversight built into the system, and the structure became lousy with corruption, dishonesty, and extortion. So Augustus canceled the whole setup and began employing a professional corps of tax collectors to implement a tax code that reflected reasonable expectations about what the provincials ought to be able to provide. If Rome was going to rule what it had conquered, they needed to get smart about how they treated the provincials. To paraphrase a line not yet uttered by Tiberius, the point is to fleece the sheep, not skin them. Letting unscrupulous tax farmers run rampant was a persistent PR nightmare for Rome, and Augustus's reforms there probably paid for themselves 10 times over in the costs not borne by future generations, putting down revolts that would have inevitably sprung up when the sheep started getting skinned. Augustus also took a hard look at the organization of the legions. Since the reforms of Marius, the army had been populated with professional soldiers whose income depended on their generals winning battles and securing loot. As Augustus himself could attest, if an ambitious general wanted to turn his armies against the state, there was little to stop him as long as the men were handsomely paid. The princeps was confident that the generals and men of the army were loyal to him personally for now, but after he died, there was no telling what was going to happen. A likely scenario, though, was that every ambitious general was going to turn on every other ambitious general, plunging Rome back into civil war. So Augustus set up a central treasury for the payment of soldiers and veterans, providing the seed money for the new treasury out of his own pocket. With the men knowing that their salaries came from Rome and not from the local general in charge, they would be far less likely to follow him if his ambition took him beyond the law. Not that it wouldn't happen, mind you, just that it would be a lot less likely. With all he could do in a single lifetime, as done as he could ever hope it would be, Augustus began to withdraw from public life. He stopped coming to meetings of the Senate and relied on Tiberius and Germanicus to be the public face of the regime. Tiberius already had most of the powers that Augustus held, and for all intents and purposes, they were co-rulers by this point, which was of course by design. When Augustus died, Tiberius would not really need to ascend to the throne. He would simply need to continue to wield all the power he already had. But the growing power of Tiberius, so necessary for a smooth handover, also changed the overall outlook of the late Augustan regime. Augustus had always been advised by Maecenas to allow for a large degree of freedom when it came to the arts and the letters. That is to say, that Augustan Rome enjoyed something like freedom of speech. Critics were free to speak their minds, and old enemies of the Caesars, Brutus, Cassius, and Cato, were allowed to be described in glowing terms. Augustus may not have liked what he heard, but it was far better to let a man have his say than try to censor him. A man who believes he can speak his mind will air his grievances in public and be done with it, while a man who is stifled will not suddenly be less aggrieved. He will merely speak of them privately and with other like-minded individuals. And that, of course, is where truly dangerous conspiracies are born. But Tiberius, lacking the self-confidence of Augustus, proved to be very touchy about criticism, and in the last years of Augustus's life, it became more dangerous to criticize the regime openly than it had been in the past. In a sign of things to come, public criticism of the regime came to be conflated with treason, and where once a book highlighting the moral failings of imperial allies would have passed unnoticed, now it was grounds for banishment. But the bed Tiberius was making would not be Augustus's to lie in. No, all that was left for him to do was put the final spin on the events of his life, make sure his affairs were in order, and wait patiently for death. To the first end, he composed what had become known as the Deeds of the Divine Augustus, a listing of all the things he had accomplished in his long life. When he finally settled on the final draft in 14 AD, he ordered that the deeds were to be published on tablets and spread throughout the empire upon his death. The list turned out to be a masterpiece of not quite revisionist history. That is, he did what he said he did. None of the deeds listed are lies. But he also did quite a few other things, too. things that he didn't necessarily want to highlight for eternity, if you catch my drift. The horror of the prescriptions, for example, don't make the cut. I've posted a link to a translation of the document on the website if you want to browse the list in its entirety. I think my favorite part, listed right there amidst the battles he won, the temples he built, the provinces he brought into the empire, the honors he received, and the honors he turned down, is when he describes the spectacle of a naval battle he staged for the people after digging an enormous hole near the Tiber and filling it with water. Some 3,000 men and 30 large ships participated in a giant mock sea battle. Hey guys, remember that? That was awesome, huh? At the same time he was placing the final draft of the deeds for safekeeping with the Vestal Virgins, Augustus also deposited three other documents. One described in detail the military and financial situation of the empire, tax rolls, troop locations, project timelines, the works, everything Tiberius would need to immediately understand what he had inherited. The second document laid out in detail how he wanted his funeral procession to unfold. And the last was his final will, which contained only one posthumous surprise for Rome. In the spring of 14 AD, for reasons that will forever be open to historical interpretation, Augustus decided to visit his exiled grandson, Posthumus Agrippa, who had been living on a small, barren island these past 7 years. Explanations for the visit range from Augustus needing to take stock of the boy to see if he was fit to return to society, to Augustus needing to take stock of the boy to see if he had any plans to overthrow Tiberius once the old man was dead, to Augustus needing to take stock of the boy to decide whether or not he could possibly push Tiberius aside and make Posthumus his heir. There is also some disagreement about whether Livia knew anything about the meeting and what her reaction to the encounter might have been. According to the Livia killed everyone faction, Augustus tried to keep the meeting secret, but Livia found out about it anyway. Afraid of what this meant for Tiberius, she would order the assassination of Posthumus as soon as Augustus was dead. And, oh yeah, according to the Livia killed everyone theory, she's about to kill Augustus too, but we'll get to that. Others speculate that she knew full well about the meeting and its result, that Augustus determined Posthumus was too dangerous, that he would welcome any opportunity to become a rallying point for anti-Tiberian partisans, and that Augustus was leaving orders that Posthumus be killed upon his death. There is really no coming to a firm conclusion about the meeting, but we know that it happened, and what happened to Posthumus as soon as Augustus was dead. He was killed. Whether the princeps ordered it because he was worried about the stability of the empire, or Livia ordered it because she feared for her own son's career, is anyone's guess. But perhaps belaying the notion, at least, that Augustus was set to push Tiberius aside and make Posthumus his heir, in the summer of 14 AD, he ordered Tiberius to take over the critical command in Illyricum. This meant that Augustus was putting Tiberius in charge of a large chunk of the Roman army while simultaneously keeping him close to Italy. Posthumus, meanwhile, continued to sit on a lifeless rock and was left out of Augustus's so recently revised will. That probably tells us all we need to know about whether Augustus was planning to replace Tiberius as his heir. In the early summer of 14, Tiberius set out for Brundisium to take over his command in the Balkans and was accompanied for the first leg of his journey by Augustus himself. But the two parted ways about 150 miles south of Rome. Tiberius continued south, while Augustus peeled off and made his way to one of his villas in the town of Nola, which lay in the shadow of Mount Vesuvius. His health had been deteriorating for some time, and lately he had come down with another serious illness. Publicly, he was settling into the villa to recuperate away from the hustle and bustle of Rome, but those close to the princeps knew that he was really settling in to die. It had been a long life, a good life, but it was time to let go. On the 19th of the month that now bears his name, with Livia by his side, Gaius Julius Caesar Augustus finally died. He was 76 years old and had ruled Rome for 44 years. His attributed final words, depending on the translation, went, "Have I played my part in the farce of life well enough?" He followed this with a common tagline used by actors when closing out their performances, "If I have pleased you, then kindly signify appreciation with a warm goodbye." To Augustus, all the world really was but a stage. I think it's safe to say that he played his part convincingly. Like everything else surrounding the last few months of Augustus's life, there is some disagreement about what happened next. Either Tiberius was recalled to Nola when Augustus was still dying and the two were able to go over the last details of succession, or he was only alerted once the princeps was dead and that Livia spent a few days keeping her husband's death a secret while she waited for Tiberius to arrive. There is also some disagreement about how and why Augustus finally died, namely, whether he died of natural causes or was poisoned by his wicked wife Livia. I don't tend to think that dying at the age of 76, after a life spent in and out of sick beds, needs a conspiracy theory to explain it, but rumors persist to this day that Livia poisoned the figs Augustus was fond of eating because she was afraid that if Augustus kept living, he might change his mind about her son. In his biography of Augustus, Anthony Everett does some fancy mental gymnastics to reconcile the ambiguity surrounding Augustus's death by wondering if perhaps, with all the pieces in place for a smooth transition and Augustus's final illness not proving fatal enough, that he and Livia had a nod-wink agreement for her to poison the figs. If life was merely theater, and Augustus had written his script such that now it was time for him to die, there was no sense in lingering on the stage and risking the whole production. As I alluded to earlier, immediately upon the death of Augustus, imperial agents hastened to the island where Agrippa Postumus was exiled and the young man was murdered. As I said, the two prime suspects for the order were Augustus or Livia, but many drew the conclusion that Tiberius might have been behind the murder. When confronted with these accusations, though, Tiberius made a great stink about opening an inquiry into the case in order to clear his own name. When Augustus and Livia's inner circle caught wind that Tiberius was perhaps getting ready to air some dirty laundry, they moved quickly to stop the accusations against the new emperor so that he would drop the matter. It was a dangerous time for the regime. There were still doubts about whether or not it could survive Augustus. Now was not the time to go around embracing transparency. After his obligatory stay in Nola, Tiberius traveled to Rome and delivered news of Augustus's death to the Senate. In Tacitus's famously direct language, two pieces of news became known simultaneously. Augustus was dead, and Tiberius was now in control. This was exactly as Augustus had planned the handover to take place. No power vacuum was to open up, not even for a moment. Immediately, the Senate fell into line and hailed Tiberius as their new emperor, and then set about trying to one-up each other with proposed honors for the now dead Augustus. They also started drawing up elaborate funeral arrangements. But, of course, Augustus had already provided the details of his funeral, leaving nothing to chance. When Tiberius read the princeps wishes aloud, the Senate deferred, just like they always had. Tiberius then read to them the last will and testament of Caesar Augustus, which famously began, "Since fate has cruelly carried off my sons Gaius and Lucius, Tiberius must inherit 2/3 of my property." In other words, "Dear Tiberius, I never did like you." After making room for small payments to every citizen in Rome, Augustus left the remaining third of his estate to his wife Livia, who, the Senate was astonished to learn, he was posthumously adopting as his daughter. The adoption would ensure that she would be allowed to maintain her power and position, drawing strength not because of her marriage to Augustus, which was now obviously at an end, but because she was his daughter, status that she could never lose. Henceforth, she would be known as Livia Augusta, or simply, the Augusta. The body of Augustus was borne back to Rome, and the funeral procession he had laid out was carefully followed. The official funeral orations were delivered by Tiberius and his natural son Drusus. The body was cremated in the forum, and the ashes placed in the family mausoleum that Augustus had constructed. At this point, he also formally joined the pantheon of Roman gods, and is forever after referred to as the Divine Augustus, whose pronouncements and policies took on an almost holy character. Tiberius certainly justified many of the decisions of his early reign by pointing out that he was merely following the lead of the divine Augustus. For example, in his final paperwork, Augustus implored Rome to stay within the settled boundaries of the empire. This injunction was adhered to not just by Tiberius, but more or less by every one of their successors, the only real exception being Claudius's annexation of Britain and Trajan's campaigns in the early 100s, most of the fruits of which were immediately abandoned by his successor Hadrian anyway. Over the course of his long life, Augustus changed the face of Rome. He had taken it from shaky republic to outright autocracy and ensured that the empire never looked back. His institutional reforms cleared out most of the inefficiencies that threatened to drag down Rome's domination of the whole of the Mediterranean, while the ruthless purges of his enemies guaranteed that all the energy to go back to the old ways had been eliminated. The Republic was dead, but Rome would live. His life was complicated, his motives sometimes pure and sometimes not, and historians and scholars throughout the ages have variously described him as a maniacal tyrant, a puppet of his wife, and a wise, benevolent dictator. He is almost universally referred to, though, as Rome's greatest and most successful emperor. Most believe that his long reign set the foundations for Rome's continued status as the preeminent power of the ancient world. Whether this was a good thing or not depends on who you talk to, but there is no denying that Augustus was one of the most influential men in the history of the Western world. Now, he passes from the stage. Next week, we will plunge into the early years of Tiberius's reign as emperor and his rivalry with the charismatic and popular Germanicus. The young prince may have been oblivious to the fact that his popularity was far eclipsing that of his uncle, but Tiberius certainly wasn't. It's not that Tiberius was a bad emperor early on, just that he wound up playing the socially awkward Nixon to Germanicus's easygoing Kennedy. Germanicus's popularity at the expense of Tiberius played right into the persecution complex that the emperor had carried around with him his whole life. So while we don't know for sure that he played a role in the untimely death of his nephew, the people of Rome certainly believed that he did, which did nothing for his popularity. This negative feedback loop ate at Tiberius, but he took comfort in the fact that his own son Drusus now had no rival for the throne and would be able to follow in his father's footsteps. But when, in 23 AD, Drusus either died from an illness or, more likely, was killed by his wife and her lover Sejanus, Tiberius lost the last thing keeping him grounded, which proved to be very, very bad for the citizens of Rome.